Welcome to The Edge of Grace from Edgewood Family Fellowship in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, the city of five seasons. We invite you to spend the next 30 minutes with our pastor, Dr. Craig Bex, as he shares God's Word with us.
This work, there's no opportunity. But Jesus is saying to Nicodemus, and he's saying to you and me today, listen to the wind, Nicodemus. Listen to the wind. Remember Easter, and remember Pentecost, and remember the mighty burst of the Holy Spirit that came on your soul that day you were saved. Oh, I remember. I remember that day that the Holy Spirit came upon me and saved me and made me a new creation in Christ Jesus. God's Spirit is active forever. On that fact rests all of our expectations in this life. The Holy Spirit will not let us go. In the blackest of the night, in all of your circumstances, if you'll open your window and listen to the wind, please be reminded, everywhere you go today, and every day hereafter, be reminded, every time you hear the wind, it's a reminder that God's Holy Spirit never ceases. Second characteristic, the sovereign spirit, freedom of the spirit. The wind blows or breathes where it will. The Spirit of God cannot be domesticated. Let me repeat that. The Spirit of God cannot be domesticated. It will blow where it goes. Man has tried to say, here is where grace is valid. Here is where the Holy Spirit resides. Judaism said that we are the covenant people. We have no association with the Gentiles or barbarians or the lost. Here is where the Holy Spirit resides. Here is where the Spirit of the living God resides. Then one day, out of the darkness of the tomb, Jesus burst forth, and the Spirit of God took the Judaism and all of its faith and laws and buried it in the time of history. The Holy Spirit acts as it will. We cannot assume that we have a license on it and that our way is the only way. And the wind blows where it will. Men are working overtime to try to domesticate the Holy Spirit. The Church of England charged Charles Wesley as a heretic because he took the gospel of Jesus Christ outside the people, into the streets of the common man, and they called that heresy. Well, we're the product of that heresy, because there's no way that you can combine the Holy Spirit to a church or a religion or a faith or a sect. Oh, there's a sect that say, here is the Holy Spirit, or there's a method of evangelism saying that, oh, this is the way the Holy Spirit works, or this old-time religion, that's where the Holy Spirit works, or this type of preaching, that's where the Holy Spirit works, or this type of singing is where the Holy Spirit works. We will not and cannot domesticate the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will bury man's best efforts to domesticate him. He goes where he will. The Spirit of God embarrasses our human preconceptions. Rahab the harlot was found in the lineage of Jesus Christ. A harlot was in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Jesus was born of a teenage virgin in a stable and had no earthly father. Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Nazareth, not Rome or Alexandria. Jesus was a carpenter, not a priest or a king. Jesus died on a wooden cross between two thieves. Jesus was buried in a borrowed grave. And they rolled that massive, great stone over the front of that tomb, and they said, Jesus is dead. He'll not bother us anymore. Holy Spirit had a different plan, didn't he? He burst forth out of that tomb with a resurrection of Jesus Christ. On the third day, the wind of heaven came rushing in, the Holy Spirit, and raised Christ from the dead. Gordon Brownville's book, Symbols of the Holy Spirit, tells about a great Norwegian explorer, Roald Amundsen. He was the first to discover the magnetic net pole and discover the South Pole. On one of his trips, Amundsen took a homing pigeon, or a dove, with him. When he had finally reached the top of the world, he released the homing pigeon from the bird's cage and set it free. Imagine the delight of his wife back in Norway when she looked up and in the sky she saw that dove, that homing pigeon, that had come all the way from the North Pole to her home in Norway. Imagine how the disciples felt when Jesus burst forth from that tomb, resurrected. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So it is when Jesus ascended. He was gone, but the disciples clung to the hope that he would send the Holy Spirit. And on Pentecost, it came. And the wind blows wherever it will. We will never be able to domesticate the Holy Spirit. There is no man or man's institution, be they arrogant political dictators, the church, or all the atheists of the world, can tame the Spirit of God. There is no unbelieving soul that can't, it's beyond his reach. There's no atheist that can't be shaken into faith. There's no dry-bone church he can't vitalize and bring to a marching army. There's no government he can't bring down. And there's no dry-bone Christian he cannot quicken. The Holy Spirit is the master of the world. And the wind blows where it will. Come, I say, come, Holy Spirit. Third, there's the indisputable evidence of the Spirit. The wind blows where it will, and though you do hear its sound, the Holy Spirit, although silent, has evidence. You see, when the wind is blowing, it makes its presence felt. You can hear the sound of it. You cannot touch it, but you can hear it. You can feel it, but you cannot touch it. The Spirit is the same way. It stirs up a church or an individual or a community. And there is palpable evidence of its presence and its working. You see, Nicodemus had heard the sound. He was a cynic. He was a Pharisee, an honest man, but a cynic. And Rabbi, he exclaims, no man could do these things, were these mighty works you do, unless God were with him. He didn't know the man, or he didn't know the message, but he heard the sound. He had heard that the dead were raised, the blind could see, the lame could walk, and the deaf could hear, and the lepers were clean. And you could hear the sound, and he heard the sound of the Holy Spirit working in the life of Christ. The pagan and the religious world heard the sound. They heard the sound of the crucifixion, and they heard the sound of the shattering earthquake, and they heard the sound of the dead raised from the dead walking around after Christ's resurrection. The entire Jewish faith heard the sound when the veil of the temple was torn from the top to the bottom. They heard the sound of the Holy Spirit. They heard the sound of the earthquake and the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And they heard the sound of the disciples when Peter preached and 3,000 souls were saved. They heard the sound of the martyred death of Stephen. They heard the sound of healings and demons being cast out. They heard the sound of Paul, now Saul, persecutor, now evangelist. And you can hear the sound. You can see the visible sign of the Holy Spirit working in the whoop and weave of man's life. You can hear the sound. Nicodemus heard the sound, and he came to Christ for more answers. The church today, Jesus proclaimed its power and the eternal work of the Holy Spirit upon and within the church. Let me read you Matthew 16, 17, and 18. Then Jesus answered him, "Blessed, happy, fortunate are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood, men, have not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven, and I tell you, are Peter, a huge rock of Gibraltar. And on this rock, a huge rock of Gibraltar, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail it. And I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven." We'll never understand how God, in all of his wisdom, left his Spirit with the church. But he's always had a people. He will always have a people. He will never be unbending in his effort to redeem his people. Number four, the unsearchable origin of the Spirit. The wind blows where it will, and though you do hear its sound, yet you neither know where it comes from. You see, the wind is kind of a mystery of sorts. In our current scientific age, we kind of got a bead on it. We can understand it better. But we have no control over it. We don't know where it comes from. We don't know where it's going to go. Holy Spirit is kind of a mystery of sorts. Oh, there's been reams of books written about the Holy Spirit, but we really don't know where it comes from. We know that it comes from the heart of God, but we have no control over it. You see, the Holy Spirit erupted on the world stage, and it burst forth in bodily form in Jesus Christ, fathered by the Holy Spirit, full of the Holy Spirit, and by the very will of God. The Spirit broke out on the world stage, and we knew not where it came from. The church at its very beginning did not start with a committee meeting with Peter and his appointees, and they wrote up a constitution and a plan to evangelize the world. The Holy Spirit burst upon the scene of Pentecost, and he decided what he was going to do with the church and with his evangelism and who was going to be saved and who was not going to be saved. The Holy Spirit was there during the birth of the church, and it was there during the persecution when Stephen was martyred with stoning. And the church was dispersed, and the Spirit of God broke out. Saul of Tarsus, Saul called Paul, or Paul called Saul on the road of Tarsus, didn't have the gospel explained to him by an evangelist. The Holy Spirit broke out on him and saved his mighty soul. The Holy Spirit decided that it was time that Paul would turn from his wicked ways and be a testimony for the Christ of Christ. And through the ages, we've had revival after revival after revival in the church. And we can stand here today and we can say we're barren and we're lonely and we don't know where to go. But I'm telling you, the Spirit of God is ceaseless. It blows. It blows where it will, and it comes from the heart of God. And don't ever count God out. He will redeem his church, and we will have a revival again soon. We would like to rationalize the Holy Spirit away, but we cannot. Fifth and last, the incalculable destiny of the Holy Spirit. The wind blows where it will, And though you do hear it sound, yet you neither know where it comes from or where it's going. We stand here in a moment of time, trapped in today in our memories. And what has happened in history in the past, in our own personal life, the history of church, and the history of mankind. But I'm telling you, we do not know where the Spirit is going. We better open our ears and listen, because there's a sound. I can hear the sound. He's moving. He's moving in this church. Open your ears. There's a sound, and He's moving. You cannot tell where the Holy Spirit will carry you. Get ready for a journey, as no man can tell where the Spirit of God in Christian discipleship will carry you. Example was Nicodemus. He went from a cynical Pharisee to a disciple of Christ. He went from a cynical Pharisee to the observer at the cross. He went from a cynical Pharisee to Pontius Pilate council asking for the body of Christ. He went from a cynical Pharisee to the burial of Jesus in the tomb, and from a cynical Pharisee to the resurrection of Christ. And the wind blows, and we do not know where it will go. And I do not know where God is going to take me. And you do not know where God is going to take you. But I'm telling you, He's on the move. He's ceaseless. He's blowing. He's taking the church. He's going to take you if you'll stand and lift your sail and let Him be your wind. The disciples in the upper room had no idea where the Holy Spirit was going to take them. They had no clue that when Peter preached that 3,000 souls would be saved and their families that day, one day. They didn't know that. He just preached and the Holy Spirit was there. They didn't know that they were going to evangelize all the known world. And they didn't know that each one of them was going to die a martyr. And the wind blows, and we know not where it will go. A young medical student who's just graduated from a prestigious university, looking forward to influential position and financial rewards, and the Spirit calls them to the mission field with no influence and a pittance in return. A young woman is immersed in the ordinary daily affairs, and she's called to witness to somebody in the office or in the factory or on the street or to a friend. The Holy Spirit comes upon a church that's proud of its heritage and of its past, that feels justified of its great history, and compels that church to take a radical words of Jesus seriously. And Jesus said in Matthew 10:39, whoever finds his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. As a young man, Oswald Chambers, of the book The Utmost for His Highest Fame, battled a persistent sense of barrenness in his Christian life. He finally wrote, I was getting desperate. I knew no one who had what I wanted. In fact, I didn't know exactly what I did want. But I knew that if this was all Christianity was cracked up to be, it was a fraud. Then a little meeting in Dunan, a well-known lady was asked to take the after service. She did not speak, but set us to prayer. And they sang the song, Touch Me Again, Lord. I felt nothing, Oswald said, but I knew emphatically my time had come. I rose to my feet. Then and there I claimed the gift of the Holy Spirit in dogged commitment to Luke 11:13. Write that verse down. Luke 11:13. If you don't get anything else from this message this morning, remember that verse. Luke 11:13. Let me read it. If you then, evil as you are, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask and continue to ask? Have you ever read that verse? Have you ever prayed that verse? Have you ever got to the end of your Christianity when it's all barren and it looks like a fraud? Well, God has an answer for you. It's the fullness of the Holy Spirit. And you can ask for it. And as a heavenly Father that loves you more than your father loved you, He will give it to you. As Oswald Chambers says, I stood on the promises. I didn't feel any different, but I claimed the promises of Luke 11:13. He continues, I had no vision of heaven nor of angels, he said. I had nothing. I was as dry and empty as ever. No power or realization of God. No witness of the Holy Spirit. Then I was asked to speak at a meeting, and 40 souls came to know Christ that night. I came to realize that God intended me, having asked for the filling of the Holy Spirit, to take Him at His word. And He did. And Oswald Chambers' whole Christian walk was changed by that. We don't know where the wind is going to take us. I went downstairs this morning and I talked to the teenagers down in the Hebrews coffee room, and I shook their hands, and I shook your hand, and I shook your hand, and I shook your hand. You do not know where the Holy Spirit is going to take you. You are the future of our church. You may be a pastor. You may be a pastor. You may be a minister and evangelist. I don't know. We do not know. At my age, at your age, wherever you are at, when you pray that prayer, you do not know where the wind blows. But I'm telling you, I've got an answer for you there. God's word tells us this, but the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and patience and forbearance and kindness and goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, meekness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. So this morning, you've heard. The Holy Spirit is ceaseless. It has sovereign freedom. It's going to go where it wants to go. There's evidence of it, indisputable evidence. We have the history on our side with the death, burial, and resurrection and ascension of Jesus Christ. The source of the Holy Spirit is unsearchable, and the destiny of the Holy Spirit and where He'll take you is unknowable. But I can tell you, you're in the hands of loving, caring God. Now I'd like to close with the same prayer that I began with. However the message has touched you today, if you're here this morning and you're backslid and you say that, well, God could never redeem me, remember Peter. If you're here this morning and you're Nicodemus and you'd like to be know who God is and know His kingdom and you want to be born again, the Holy Spirit's here today. It's a prayer for you. If you're here this morning and you're dry bones and you're tired of it, you're a Christian, but you're tired of dry bones, pray this prayer with me this morning. Hover over me, Holy Spirit. Bathe my trembling heart. And fill me now with your holy presence. Come, O Spirit, and fill me now. You can fill me, gracious Spirit, even though I cannot tell you how. But I need you. I need all of you. Come, oh come, and fill me now. Cleanse and comfort and bless and strengthen me. Bathe me in thy Spirit now. You are my strength and comfort. Thank you for filling me now. As we continue our service this morning in our tithes and offerings, if the ushers would come forward, they will have a prayer of thanksgiving and praise. And I think we have Bob and John and Dick and Joe. If you'd come forward, thank you very much for being able and willing servants to serve the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning as an offering first of ourselves. And we rejoice in what you have given for us. And we make our offering to you this morning with a whole heart. We know that a generous man prospers. And he who refreshes others is refreshed. We thank you this morning for this privilege of continuing our worship service with our tithes and offerings. And as we do this, we ask for your blessing and your grace and mercy, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, I'm Pastor Craig Bex. I want to thank you for joining us today on The Edge of Grace. We're excited about being a part of the KFXB family, especially excited to have you as a part of our family. It's our prayer that you were blessed by the program today, and that in some small way we were able to encourage you with God's Word. You know, the most important thing that you can do for us is let us know that you've joined us. Would you do that? You can write us at The Edge of Grace, 621 Edgewood Road Northwest, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, 52405. Or you can go to our website, www.effcr.org, and there you'll find email addresses through which you can reach us. We're not selling a product, just sharing Jesus. But if you'd like to partner with us, you can send your gifts to the same address, 621 Edgewood Road Northwest, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, or online at our website. You'll find a Donate Online tab that you can use to send your gift to us that way. If you have a church home, I commend you to it. Encourage you to be faithful in your attendance and your giving. If you don't have a church home, we invite you to join us at Edgewood Family Fellowship, again located at 621 Edgewood Road Northwest in Cedar Rapids. Our worship service is at 10 o'clock each Sunday morning, and there's a great children's ministry during that time as well. We promise you unconditional love, uncompromised preaching, and unparalleled fellowship. Until next week, we pray you'll come and join us. I think you'll be glad you did. You be blessed and be a blessing.